Hello students, today we are going to discuss about the alkalinity of water. Also we will see what are the biochemical effects of the heavy metals and which is the continuation of the water pollution and control chapter. And today our lecture is 19. So let's start. So students, today we will discuss, as you know, that is the chapter, the name of the chapter is water pollution and control, and our lecture number is, that is 19. So these are some of the objectives of our today's class. First of all, we can define, after this class we can define the alkalinity of water. Second objective of our class is you can discuss about the nutrients. And also you can know what is the process of eutrophication. And at last you can know what are the biochemical effects of the heavy metals. That we will, four heavy metals that you have in your syllabus, and we will discuss in detail. So these are the topics that we have already discussed. That is the recapitulation of previous class. What we have done, we have solved so many problems which is based on the rate constant of BOD reaction. We have defined what is the hardness of water. We can also classify the hardness of water now, and you knew the process of removal of hardness. Generally, hardness is of two types. One is temporary, and as you know about the permanent hardness, and both hardness we can remove, and the process also you knew, as we have discussed in our previous class. Okay, so this is our quick review. Whatever you have understood, whatever you knew from the previous classes. So the question is, zeolite is the blank process of removal of permanent hardness. So you have to fill in the blanks here. For this, you will get the 10 seconds. Now your time starts now. Okay, so your time is over. So yes, of course, the answer is external process. Zeolite is the process of removal of the permanent hardness, and this is called external process. Generally, we have three types of external process. One is soda lime, one is zeolite, and one is, yes, iron exchange resin. So this is the hardness of water. Already you knew that the hardness is the soap consuming capacity. Generally, hardness is causing due to presence of bicarbonates, chlorides, sulfates and carbonates of the calcium and magnesium. Now if we have the these are some of the disadvantages of hardness. So hard water we cannot use for the domestic purpose and for the industrial purpose also, as we have so many disadvantages for using the hard water. Like for washing purpose, if we use the hard water, the soap cannot form the ladle, so washing should not be in proper manner. So that is why for washing purpose we cannot use the hard water. Like cooking, for cooking purpose we are using the temperature, so at that temperature whatever the dissolved salts are there into the water, that will form a layer inside the wall of the cooking utensils, and thus it will destroy it. So that is why for the cooking purpose also we cannot use the hard water, and obviously hard water we cannot consume. So these are the some of the disadvantages of the hard water for using the industrial purpose. Like we have the disadvantages in the textile industry, in sugar industry. In sugar industry, what will happen if we use the hard water? The crystallization of sugar will be very difficult. So that is why we can't use in the sugar industry. The dyeing industry, we cannot use. The paper industry also, we cannot use the hard water. And after all, steam generation in the boiler, what will happen in the factory, generally we use the boilers for the steam generation. So if we use into the boiler the hard water, what will happen, all the salts will form the layers inside the wall of the boiler, and the efficiency of the boiler will be destroyed, and after all the caustic embrittlement will take place. So all these are the some disadvantages for using the hard water. So that is why first of all we have to remove the hard water, hardness of the water, and then that water, that soft water, we can use. Hardness, generally for that we should know there are two types of hardness. One is temporary, one is permanent. As we know ki bicarbonates are causing the temporary hardness, and permanent hardness chloride and sulfates, so chloride, sulfates, carbonates of the calcium, magnesium are generally causing the permanent hardness. Now these are the some of the removal process. This is the removal process of temporary hardness. Only by boiling the water, temporary hardness can be removed, just by boiling the water. Okay, and for permanent hardness we are having so many process. One is external process, as I told you, and also we have the internal process. External process, there are three types. One is soda lime, zeolite and annexing resin. Or and for internal process we can use calgon conditioning, phosphate conditioning or colloidal conditioning. These are the some of the process which we can use for the removal of the permanent hardness. And this is the zeolite, this is the construction of the zeolite. So here, from here the hard water will pass through the zeolite, and all the salts, all the cations and anions will be stuck here. And after all, whatever from the outlet, whatever water we are getting, that will be free from any hardness, permanent hardness. And this is the annexing resin. This also we can use for the removal of permanent hardness. For this annexing resin, these are the two chambers are there. One is cation chamber, one is anion chamber. Cation exchanger or anion exchanger. So generally what will happen here, the all the types of cations will be stuck here, and anion exchanger, all the anions will be stuck here. So after all, whatever water we are getting, that is free from permanent hardness. So all these are the recapitulation of the previous class. I'm telling again because these are the very tricky, and this is very important one, because from this portion frequently you are asked like this type of question, to classify hardness, how we can remove the temporary hardness, how we can remove the permanent hardness by using annexing resin, what is the working principle of zeolite process, what is how we can remove the permanent hardness by using soda lime process. So these are the very common questions frequently you can have in your exam. That is why I am repeating. Now today we will discuss. So already these are the some of the chemical parameters we have discussed, that is pH, chemical oxygen demand, dissolved oxygen, BOD, total hardness we have discussed. Today we will discuss about the alkalinity and also the heavy metals. Okay, now so alkalinity. Now first question is, what do you mean by alkalinity? Actually alkalinity, this is the basic nature of the water. Now we can define also alkalinity by the chemical measurement. Alkalinity is the chemical measurement of the water's ability to neutralize the acid. Okay, so the buffering capacity. So the whatever buffering capacity the water is having, that is, that can be defined as alkalinity. So why this alkalinity, water is showing this alkaline nature? Because of presence of these ions, like this is the bicarbonate ACO3-, this is the CO3- to carbonate ion, and this is the hydroxyl OH-. So these all ions are responsible for the alkaline nature of the water. Okay, so among these, bicarbonate ACO3- is the weak one, and CO3- to NOH minus, these anions are the strong base. Okay, so one more thing, alkalinity already you have in your chemistry lab syllabus that alkaline, you can determine the alkalinity of the water. So what you have done, you have taken the tap water sample, you have added some of the indicator. Generally in our lab we have the, in our tap water, the bicarbonate, so that is why you have used methyl orange. Okay, and you have titrated against the acid, and after that you can get the value of the alkalinity. So this is the procedure by which we can measure the alkalinity of the water. Already you have done in your lab class also. Okay, so now what is the importance? What is the importance of alkalinity of water? Why we are discussing alkalinity? Okay, so these are the some of the importance. One thing, if we know the nature, alkaline nature of the water, if we know how much alkaline the water, our water sample is, that will provide the information about how sensitive the water body will be to the acid. Okay, so the water's buffering capacity we can know. Also, if we have the hardness and permanent hardness, and we have to remove that permanent hardness by the soda lime process. So, if we know that water, for that water sample, what is the alkalinity of that water sample, so we can actually calculate the amount of the lime and soda required for the removal of the permanent hardness. Okay, so that means for one sample, for that sample we have to measure the how much soda and how much lime is required for the removal of that process, so that we can know, if we know for the sample the alkalinity the value. Okay, and alkalinity is another importance is, if we know the alkalinity of a water sample, that can control, that time we can control the corrosion in piping system. Corrosion is very important process, so, and disadvantageous process. So we have to, for prevention of the metal from the corrosion, we should know how the corrosion is taking place. Okay, so that is why here also alkalinity is very having the important role. Okay, now next our topic is, that is eutrophication. That is another important topic, eutrophication. Now eutrophication, mainly what will happen in water sample, all we know, for any type of living system we require the nutrients. Okay, so in water, for the aquatic lives also, there are elements, some nutrients we have into the water also, water body also, which is important for the aquatic life. Okay, like sodium, calcium, magnesium, potassium. So these are the some of the important elements, that the important nutrients that we have in the water sample. Now what will happen, day by day by our activity, we are polluting the water, and for that the level of the nutrients will be high. If the level of the nutrients will be high, what is the adverse effect of that process? This you can see in the picture, the total water body is, look here, the total water body is covered by the algae, by the phytoplanktons. Okay, so while the for pollution, for general, if we pollute the water, the that means the increase of nutrients, in that water body, the nutrients will increase. If the nutrients amount will increase, it will stimulate the growth of this algae, the phytoplankton. And what will happen if the water body is totally covered with the algae, phytoplankton, they will consume the dissolved oxygen more. And thus, what will happen into the water body, the amount of dissolved oxygen level decreasing, and which is very harmful for other aquatic life, because we don't have only the algae, phytoplankton into the water body. Also, there are other animals we have, like fish, small fish, large fish, and that will be very harmful for them. And you can see in this picture, after all, if the we are having the decrease in dissolved oxygen, what will happen? It can kill the animals also, aquatic lives also. Okay, so all the total whole procedure is called by the eutrophication. This process is called eutrophication. So eutrophication, mainly how it will happen, why the amount of nutrients level will increase. Okay, nutrients are very important for all type of living system, but in the but in limited amount. Now, by our activity, what will happen, day by day the amount of the nutrients will increase. So what will happen? It will stimulate the growth of algae, plants, understand? So what will happen? While their growth is very rapid, so that means their consumption of dissolved oxygen will be very high. So that means what will happen into the water body? Gradually the level of dissolved oxygen will decrease, and that is the very harmful for other aquatic life. Okay, so this is the process of eutrophication. Yeah, massive algae blooms. It will block the light to plants below the habitat, whatever we have in the water body, destroy the smaller species also. Okay, So these are the some of the cause of the eutrophication, causes of the eutrophication. Now look, so first thing is use of fertilizers. What will happen? The farmers are using the fertilizers in excessive amount because they don't know how much amount they have to use for the crops. Okay, so they are using excessive amount of fertilizers. What will happen? That excessive amount will enter into the water body, will discharge into the water body, and thus it will increase the level of the nutrients. Okay, so what will happen? After using the excessive amount of fertilizers, ultimately it will increase the level of the nutrients into the water body. Next cause is discharge of wastewater into the water body. Now you can see very frequently that from industry, from factory, they are discharging the wastewater into the water body. Okay, into here the water body. So what will happen? This wastewater also, what will happen? It will also increase the level of dissolved oxygen, increase the level of nutrients, and which will stimulate the growth of these plants, growth of the algae. Okay, so what will happen after that? Ultimately, the dissolved oxygen level decreasing, and which is very harmful for other aquatic life. And these are the some of the causes of the eutrophication. One more cause we have, that is the over the years, what will happen? The lakes accumulate large quantities of solid materials. So that solid materials, what will happen? It can absorb the nutrients, large amount of nutrients. So if the increased amount of large quantities of solid material, that means it will increase also the amount of nutrients into the water body, and ultimately the eutrophication process will take place. So these are the some of the effects of the eutrophication. Generally what will happen by our activities, the level of nitrogen, phosphorus, these type of nutrients will increase. So what will happen, that will increase the stimulate the growth of the organic matter, that means plants, algae, and thus the dissolved oxygen will decreasing, and which is very harmful for the aquatic life. And also the decrease the light availability. If the the water body is covered with the plants, with the algae, what will happen, the that will decrease the availability of the light, and which is harmful for the aquatic life. So these are the all some of the effects of the eutrophication that we have. So now how we can control this eutrophication? Only we can control this eutrophication, first of all we should be aware of this eutrophication, aware of this process. Second thing, all the whatever fertilizers we are using, we should not discharge it into the water body, and we should not use it in the excessive amount. Second thing, waste water should not discharge into the water body, any type of water body. First of all, it should be purified, and after that we can reuse again that water also. So these type of some of the process, if we follow, that time we can control only the eutrophication process. Okay, now second is the third topic, that is biochemical effects of heavy metals. Biochemical effects of heavy metals. So in your syllabus you have arsenic, cadmium, mercury and lead. These four heavy metals you have. Okay, so what are the sources of heavy metals? Generally you know, any type of industry, any type of society, mining, agriculture, okay, any type of factory. From all these, they are discharging into the water body this type of heavy metals, the toxic heavy metals, that is arsenic, cadmium, mercury, lead. They are very toxic for us, and main sources are of this heavy metals are industry, factory, mining, nuclear power plant. Okay, so the sources of mercury. Mercury generally we are getting from the mining, from the by burning of fossil fuels, that will also generate the mercury. Or if we have the paint, some of the paint also from the municipal medical waste also we will get the mercury. Okay, so these are the some of the sources of mercury, from where mercury is mixing to the water body. These are the some lead, how lead is mixed mixing with the water body, like some of the paint having the lead. So lead based paint we are using some of the food stuff. In this food stuff also, that is containing the lead. So all these are discharging into the water. All these we are consuming through the water and through our food. Here arsenic contamination, generally mining, from the glass factory, from the mining, from wood preserving factory, paint, from this all this industry we are getting the arsenic into the water. And also these are some of the sources, general sources, like metallurgical industry, mining, as I told you, agriculture, waste disposal, industrial smoke, corrosion. So all these are causing the contamination of heavy metals, contamination of water with the heavy metals. Okay, now one by one we will see what are the biochemical effects of heavy metals. First, mercury. Mercury is very toxic. Okay, so if we consume the mercury contaminated water, what are the effects generally we have? We can have the emotional, some of the emotional changes we can have. We can have weakness, muscle atrophy, twitching we can have, headache we can have, and ultimately if we consume a very large amount of mercury through the water, so what will happen? The kidney damage can, there will be the possibility of kidney damage, there will be the possibility of respiratory failure, and so many diseases we can have if we consume the mercury contaminated water. Next is lead. Lead is also very harmful in its lead plus 2 form or lead plus 4. If lead is lead plus 2 form or lead plus 4, it will be very harmful, as lead plus 2 can inhibit the synthesis of hemoglobin. Okay, it also interferes the normal development of children's brain. Okay, like they can have some of the behavioral effects, including lack of attentiveness, or they can have the low IQ for the lead consumption of the water. Okay, so these are the some of the biochemical effects of lead. Okay, next we will see what are the biochemical effects of cadmium. Okay, so mainly cadmium is contaminated in the form of cadmium plus 2, and this cadmium plus 2 can enter into our food chain by from the seafood, by the organ meats. Okay, so cadmium is actually very toxic at the level of 1 gram. What will happen if we consume cadmium contaminated water? What will happen? So we can have the kidney disease. Okay, the chronic exposure to the high level of cadmium. Also, if we have the excessive amount of cadmium, it can store into our liver and kidney, which is very harmful again for us. And all we know that this is the Itai disease. So this disease is very known due to the presence of cadmium in any human body. Okay, so these are the some of the biochemical effects of the cadmium. Next we will see what is the biochemical effect of arsenic. Okay, so generally arsenic 3 is more toxic than arsenic 5. Why? Because all these heavy metals, so one more thing, all these heavy metals like cadmium, arsenic, they are having a tendency to bind with the sulfur atom. Now, we have in the protein molecule, in the enzyme molecule, we have the sulfur atom. So, what will happen if we consume cadmium or arsenic? It can bind up with the enzymes, and thus enzymatic activity will lose. Okay, so it can interfere in the enzymatic activity. Now, arsenic 3 is more stronger. Arsenic 3 is forming more stronger bond with the sulfur atom than the arsenic 5. That is why arsenic 3 is more toxic. Okay, arsenic 3 is more toxic than the arsenic 5. Generally, arsenic compounds AS2O3, arsenate, are very commonly used in very early age for murder, for suicide. Okay, so mostly through the ingestion of contaminated water which is having the arsenic, we can have some of the biochemical effects, like we can have some of the lung disease, intestines disease. Okay, so arsenic is very much carcinogen, and also it causes severe vomiting, diarrhea. So these are all the some of the biochemical effects. One more biochemical effects, also it can inhibit the production of ATP, as it can bind up with the sulfur atom of the enzymes. So these are the some of the arsenic contaminated disease. If we consume arsenic contaminated water, we can have this type of disease. Here you can see the pictures. These are the pictures of Blackfoot disease, that is very renowned disease. Why? Because if our skin will be contact to the arsenic containing water, what will happen? We can have this type of disease. Okay, this type of disease that we can have only if we touch the arsenic containing water for a long time. So these are the very harmful, very toxic heavy metals that we should not have in our water body, and also in our drinking water, understand? So that is why, first of all, we should refine the water whatever we are consuming, and after that we can take that water, we can use that water. Okay, so all about this. Okay, so this is now, this is the recapitulation. Whatever we have discussed today, that is, first we have the new topic, first we have discussed, that is the alkalinity of water. So alkalinity of water, I'm again repeating, that is the basic nature of water. Why we have the basic nature of water? As in water we are having bicarbonates. If we have carbonate CO3-2, or if we have the hydroxide, okay, so all these anions are responsible for the alkaline nature of the water. If we have only the bicarbonate, that is the very weak base. If we have the carbonate or the hydroxide ion in our water sample, so that is the hard base. And for that, for identification, we have to use the indicator, that is phenolphthalein, for the carbonate, and for determination of the carbonate and hydroxide. And if we have only the bicarbonate in our water sample, so for that case only we have to use the methyl orange. Okay, now next we have discussed about the eutrophication. Yeah. Eutrophication, what is eutrophication? Generally, eutrophication is related to the nutrients. So in water body, all we are the living system, all we require some of the nutrients like sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, and so on. Okay, so these nutrients also we have into the water body, because these are also important for the aquatic life. Now what will happen for our activity, like we are for washing purpose in domestic case, we for washing purpose we are using so many amount of detergent. What will happen? This excessive amount of detergent will discharge into the water, that will mix to the water, and also again it will increase the amount of nutrients. Agriculture, for agricultural purpose, what will happen? The farmers are using fertilizers in excessive amount. What will happen? This excessive amount again discharge into the water, and which will increase the amount of nutrients. Now, what is the effect of this increased amount of nutrients? After increasing the nutrients, what will happen? It will rapid the growth of the plants, algae. So if it will it will stimulate the growth of the plants, what will happen? All the plants then consume the dissolved oxygen so many in large amount. So that is why it will decrease the amount of the dissolved oxygen into the water body, and which is very harmful for other aquatic life. Okay, so this whole procedure is called eutrophication. Only we can control the eutrophication by if we have the awareness. We don't have to discharge the wastewater into the water body. We don't have to discharge the excessive amount of the fertilizers into the water body. So these type of some of the control measures that we should take to reduce the amount of the eutrophication. Okay, so one more thing, there are three steps we have for the eutrophication. At first we have oligotrophic lake, second we have mesotrophic lake, and the third we have eutrophic lake. Okay, so for the oligotrophic lake, that is that the lake is very new, so the rate of the eutrophication will be very low. For mesotrophic lake, the rate of the eutrophication will be moderate, and for the eutrophic lake, the nutrients amount is very high, and for that, the what will happen? The rate of the eutrophication will be very high. Okay, now next topic, what we have discussed, that is the biochemical effects of the heavy metals. What are the heavy metals that we have discussed? That is the arsenic, cadmium, mercury, and lead. And most of the heavy metals, what will happen? They are having the they are very much prone to attach with the sulfur atoms of the enzymes, and thus if we consume these heavy metals with the water, so what will happen? That will bind up with the enzymes, and it will interfere so many enzymatic activities, and thus the reaction, so many also it will interfere the oxidation and reduction reactions that we have in our cell. Okay, so these are the all the biochemical effects of the heavy metals. That is why these heavy metals also with these heavy metals, that water we cannot consume. First of all, we have to remove the heavy metal from the water. After that, water we can use, and as well as we can also consume that water. Okay, so all these topics we have covered today. Next day we will discuss about the wastewater treatment. That is very important. Okay, so this is, that will be the last topic of this chapter, that is water pollution and control. So last day we have to discuss, so all these topics we have checked. Yeah, so thank you students. And one more thing which I say generally repeatedly, that please follow the classes properly. Please follow the classes, and that time only you can understand what are the topics we have discussed. And also you can submit, you can do the assignment and submit the assignment within the time. So that's why you have to read the study material very well, whatever I have given you, and also follow my classes. Thank you, students.